antipsychotics by breaking them up into subclasses. And I think after you finish watching the video, you'll have a much better intuitive grasp on the differences between the antipsychotics in terms of side effects and receptor profiles. So let's just jump into it. So to get started, first I'm just going to list out the second generation antipsychotics in alphabetical order. And next I'm going to circle the words pine, done, and pip and rip. And I'm taking this right from Stahl's Essential Pharmacology book, where he endearingly coins the pines, the dones, two pips, and a rip. And once you realize that the pines have a lot of similarities, the dones have a lot of similarities, and the pips and rips are similar, it's just much easier to keep the differences between the antipsychotics together. And I hope that after you watch this video, your brain just automatically views these as subclasses of the antipsychotics, and not just some silly random suffixes. So now let's rewrite the names of the drugs. So you have the pines, that's olanzapine, quetiapine, clozapine. You have the dones, that's paliperidone, risperidone, ziprasidone, and lurasidone. And of course, the pips and a rip. So these are partial agonists at D2, and they include aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, and cariprazine. So now let's just take a quick look at the chemical structures of these drugs. And I know a lot of people get intimidated by chemical structures, but bear with me here. We're really just looking at the shapes, nothing too fancy. So the reason why I'm showing you the chemical structures is that we can see that there's a reason that these drugs share certain properties. It's not that these drugs have silly quirks that make them different, but rather it's a result of their chemical structure that makes them different. And if they share chemical similarities, then they're going to have similar properties as reflected in the receptors that they're going to bind. So you can't understand every effect that a drug has just by looking at its receptor profile. And that's more the result that we don't really understand everything regarding receptor profiles or where these things bind. But I still think it's really important to have a good grasp on the different receptor profiles, because that's the main paradigm through which we understand our medications today. And a point that I make throughout a lot of my videos is that, you know, this theory doesn't explain absolutely everything there is to know and doesn't explain every effect of the drug, but that's just the result of the fact that the brain and our mind are so complex and there's no comprehensive theory that explains every single property of a drug. It doesn't mean that it's wrong or not worth learning. I just think you should learn everything you can in depth and then also be aware of the limitations of the theories that you learn. So now I'm going to list out all the receptors that these drugs hit. And if you remember, it hits these receptors sequentially from left to right, and then we dose them to block dopamine. But it's also super important to emphasize that a receptor doesn't necessarily need to be fully occupied before the drug moves on to the next receptor. The receptors exist in equilibrium, so it'll move on to the next receptor after a certain amount is bound, but it's not going to be all of it. So when you think of the fountains, just think of that there's a lot of spillover into the next tier. And one thing that's pretty confusing is that in different papers, you can see different receptor profiles for the same drug, and you can find different receptor affinities. So the important thing to take away here is the general principles and not necessarily the specifics. And I promise that learning this stuff is practical and clinically useful. So I personally have an awful memory for random facts, so looking at the receptors listed out like this, I'd feel massively overwhelmed if someone told me I had to learn them all. But now that you know that these drugs exist as sort of subclasses of the pines, the dones, the pips, and a rip, I think you'll be able to do it really easily. So without any further ado, I want to introduce pine fountain, dome fountain, and the pip-rip fountain. So basically what this fountain is doing is recognizing that there's a receptor profile backbone that exists for the pines, the dones, and the pips and the rips. So with these fountains, it's easy to memorize and you can understand the properties of the drugs and the similarities of the drug classes and also the side effect profiles of the different drug classes. A lot of the side effects of the antipsychotics are not just random properties of the drug, but they come about because of the drug's receptor profile. So for example, drugs that block histamine will cause sedation. Drugs that block M1, which are anticholinergic, will have anticholinergic side effects like dry mouth, urinary retention, tachycardia, constipation. M1 and H1, they both lead to sedation and are involved in weight gain. Drugs that block 5-HT2A or have 5-HT1A partial agonism will have less extrapyramidal side effects and less prolactin side effects. Drugs that block A1 will cause orthostatic hypotension and then a reflex tachycardia. So the reason why these fountains are useful is because you no longer have to memorize the specific side effects of different antipsychotics as if they're just completely random facts. If you know the fountains and the backbones of the receptor profiles, you can just intuit the side effects so that when you ask yourself, you know, will quetiapine or ziprasidone have more sedation? Well, you can just know that the pines block M1 and they block H1 and the dones typically don't. So you can just see from the fountains that quetiapine is going to be much worse for sedation. So here's a random chart of the antipsychotic side effects. And I always found charts like this absolutely impossible to memorize. I'd rather slam my head against a f***ing wall than be forced to memorize whether risperidone has 3 red circles or 1 yellow dot or 3 plus signs or 1 plus signs. I always feel like these kind of things, you'll look at it for a long period of time, and then 2 seconds after you're done looking at it, you'll completely forget it. But once you know the pine, the done, and the pip, and the rip fountain, looking through this thing will be a piece of cake. So now I'm going to make this chart much more manageable. So first I'm going to rearrange it in the order of the pines, the dones, and the pips, and the rip. And once we take a look at the fountains that show the receptor profile backbones, this chart will become very manageable. So if we look at something like sedation, which we know is caused by antihistamine, antimuscarinic activity, we'll see that for the pines, which have H1 and M1 in the backbone, that they're very sedating. And then aripiprazole and the dones, which don't have those receptors, tend to be less sedating. As for weight gain and hyperglycemia, there's likely another receptor that we don't really know that's involved that contributes to this. But we also know that antihistamine activity is involved. So that's why when I look at the pines, which we know typically cause the most weight gain and have the most metabolic side effects, we can see that those are worse. And then for the dones and the pips and the rips, they're not quite as bad. And then just to keep in mind, once you learn the concepts of the fountains, you'll eventually be able to get the differences within the subclasses. So if you were to take a drug like Seroquel and list out all the receptors, it sounds like an extremely daunting task. But if you take the fountain backbone and then add onto Seroquel the Seroquel-specific receptors, so on top of the backbone, you're going to add alpha-1 and add NET and add 5-HT1A. So it's really just the backbone with a few extra receptors. And then you can think of the side effects from there. So since we're adding alpha-1, we're not going to know that Seroquel has orthostatic hypotension. Since we've added NET, we know we're going to get an antidepressant effect. So thinking about it this way, it's not perfect. It's not going to explain every single property of the drug. Our brains are complex and neurons are complex, so every theory is a bit reductionistic. But when you view it this way, it's really helpful as a way to organize the differences between the drugs, and it explains a lot. And then to take the differences between the drug classes one step further, let's go back to the antipsychotic side effect chart. And let's pull up the pine class. So for the pines, we can take a look at, let's say, orthostatic hypotension. And we can see for clozapine, it hits A1, and for quetiapine, it hits A1. But the A1 receptor is missing for olanzapine. And sure enough, that's reflected in the side effects. We can see that quetiapine and clozapine have the two orange dots, and olanzapine has the one orange dot for orthostatic hypotension. And what I want to end with is that once you see these drugs as subclasses, you can pick up little patterns that exist within the classes. So, for example, quetiapine and olanzapine, these are two drugs that are indicated in treatment-resistant depression. And then with olanzapine and clozapine, these are the two drugs that have the absolute worst weight gain, but we know that clozapine is the most effective and olanzapine is typically viewed as the second most effective. And then when we move to the dones, you have paliperidone, which is the metabolite of risperidone. And then for drugs like ziprasidone and lurasidone, we know that these drugs are relatively the best with weight. And then we also know that ziprasidone and lurasidone are two drugs that require food to increase the bioavailability. So typically, we tell patients to take them with food. And then for the pips and the rips, they're kind of on an agonist spectrum, where brexpiprazole and cariprazine are more antagonistic than aripiprazole. And then my brain does a little thing that since rip is different than the pips, cariprazine also blocks D3. So I'm just pointing out that you can pick up on these little patterns once you view these drugs as different classes. All right, thanks for watching.